Hi there, and welcome to the second and final installment of a special bonus episode of Self-Inflicted Aural Nostalgia, a fan's Guided by Voices podcast. My name is Jeff Gomez, and I'm the author of Zeppelin Over Dayton, Guided by Voices album by album, which is on sale now. Today, I'll be putting Pollard's musical influences under a microscope, taking an in-depth look at the groups and the scenes which are behind the band we all know and love. This is part two of GBV DNA. The four P's, pop, psych, prog, and punk. Bob's been talking about this quartet of musical movements for decades, going so far as to declare that all of GBV includes some aspect, element, or strain from one or more of these genres. In fact, the band's name itself is a nod to these influences, Pollard telling Magnet magazine way back in 1996, "To me, that's what the name Guided by Voices has come to mean. All the voices of rock are in my head, and they guide me to make music." So then let's talk about the various voices Bob is guided by, and in terms of the four P's, which does Pollard and the band draw upon the most? How did Bob first come into contact with these formats, and which bands are the most important in each scene? And finally, what are some other categories of music that show up often in Pollard's catalog that exist outside of the four P's? Now, in looking at the four P's, I'm going to attack them what I feel to be chronological order, which is how I've just listed them: pop, psych, prog, and punk. I'm doing this because each of these scenes was very much a reaction to the one that preceded it. Psych grew out of the expanding pop scene, with bands following the lead of the Beatles, whose 1967 record, Sgt. Pepper's, showed that rock could be experimental and expansive. Just a few years later, prog built on the foundation of the psychedelic bands, with tracks like Yes's classic Close to the Edge more than doubling the running time of something like Pink Floyd's Interstellar Overdrive, which clocked in at what must have felt at the time like a mammoth 9+ minutes. In fact, in 1973, Yes would issue a double record with a mere 4 tracks. Things seemed to be getting more than just a bit overblown and out of hand, which is why punk was born shortly thereafter. And just to show how circular all of this is, the short and spiky songs of the Sex Pistols and the Buzzcocks was a kind of return to the wild and visceral pop scene that Pollard grew up with. So to kick things off, let's start at the very beginning and talk about pop music. In Britain, pop began in 1952. That's the year two momentous advances in music were introduced. The first 7-inch singles were released, and to keep track of this new compositional commodity, the pop charts were invented. In America, what's widely considered to be the modern pop era started a few years later in 1955. That's when Billboard magazine started its Top 100 chart. Billboard's chart was populated, at first, by crooners like Bing Crosby, Perry Como, and Frank Sinatra. However, by the end of the decade, the newly minted rock and roll scene gave birth to acts such as Little Richard, Jerry Lee Lewis, and Carl Perkins, not to mention Elvis Presley. Presley quickly became the world's first bona fide pop star, known around the globe and selling millions of copies of his singles and albums. In England, a similar phenomenon was happening, except instead of Elvis, they had Lonnie Donegan. Donegan wasn't as flashy as Presley, not to mention he wasn't as good-looking or charismatic, but in the end, he proved to be just as influential. His smash hit, Rock Island Line, kicked off the UK skiffle craze, and similar to how American rock and roll combined rhythm and blues with country, skiffle took these same influences and added jazz and folk to the mix. John Lennon's first group, the Quarrymen, started off as a skiffle group before branching out into rock and roll. It was, of course, Lennon's next band, the Beatles, that had the biggest impact on Bob. Pollard was not only a fan of their early catchy pop songs, but he tried to literally emulate the way that they sang. As he would later say, "I sing with a British accent because that's how the Beatles did it, and it just doesn't sound right any other way." The Rolling Stones, in their early days, tried to sound like the Southern blues legends who had inspired them. Bob was merely doing the same thing 30 years later. The rise and conquest by the Beatles of both the American and British charts ushered forth dozens of similar acts. Catchy pop songs filled the AM airwaves, pouring out of tinny transistor radios. These songs, by groups such as The Turtles, Herman's Hermits, and Jerry and the Pacemakers, were usually short and catchy, featuring memorable choruses and melodies that stayed in the head. This was the bubblegum pop music that Pollard listened to as a kid. He was in the 5th grade at the time. Bubblegum of the musical or candy variety would have been catnip to any kid. This is the sound Bob later tried and, in many instances, succeeded in replicating in the 90s using the 4-track. To get that tinny transistor radio sound, Pollard would tell Tobin Sprout to turn the bass all the way down and the treble all the way up. It should be noted that most of the great bands of these genres were English, and in the case of punk and prog, those were almost exclusively a British phenomenon, at least at the start. As Bob Stanley wrote in his book, Yeah, 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 the story of pop music from Bill Haley to Beyoncé, I think Britain's place in the development of modern pop has been crucial as a filter, sometimes as an amplifier, and occasionally as a mirror for America. So even though Pollard grew up in America's heartland, Dayton, Ohio, the majority of his influences were British. What Bob ended up taking from the classic pop era was a singing style and a sense of melody, two things that continue to this day. Think of recent tracks like Cohesive Scoops, My Angel, or The Rally Boys. Each of these are short, super catchy, and wouldn't have been out of place on the AM airwaves of the 60s. They're unabashed pop songs, showing Pollard employing pretty much perfect fashion the first of the four P's. And this influence has been there from the start. Tracks like Hank's Little Fingers or Paper Girl from early GBV LPs are super poppy. And even if you go all the way back to the band's very beginning, to the earliest GBV track in existence, Jimmy the Giant, recorded in 1974 and included as part of the first Suitcase compilation, it's a pop song. So this is a P that Pollard's been making use of for decades. Now, as the 60s progressed, bands, either net new outfits who formed towards the end of the decade or else groups from that initial phase of the British invasion, began to tire of the standard pop single. They began to branch out in terms of length, sound, and subject. And in turn, they created a new genre of music which became known as psychedelic, or as it's also called, psych. Bob's favorites, the Beatles, were one of the first bands from the pop era to go psychedelic. In an online article entitled Best Psychedelic Albums, 30 Essential Records to Expand Your Mind, Brent Milano writes, if there was one moment that changed everything and psychedelicized the world, it was the release of Strawberry Fields Forever, backed with Penny Lane, as a single in February 1967. Quite simply, the AM airwaves had never thrown out anything like that before. The release later that year of the landmark LP, Sgt. Pepper's, further solidified the Beatles' place in the pantheon of the burgeoning scene. A few months later, the Moody Blues released their symphonic Days of Future Past, the Rolling Stones released their most psychedelic album, Their Satanic Majesty's Request, and the American band Jefferson Airplane issued the experimental Bathing at Baxter's. A new musical genre had not only been born, but was taking firm hold. Author Jim DeRogatis in Turn On Your Mind, Four Decades of Great Psychedelic Rock, wrote that, great psychedelic rock tries to transport the listener someplace that exists only in the space between the headphones, while never neglecting the drive, melody, and immediacy essential to all great rock and roll. One of the ways psych did this was through instrumentation. Psychedelic bands ventured beyond the standard rock dynamic of guitar, drums, and bass to incorporate keyboards and organs such as the mellotron or even the harpsichord. They also, led by the pioneering production work of George Martin, used the recording studio as yet another instrument. This meant incorporating effects like backwards tapes or tape edits to create songs that doubled or tripled the typical length of a pop song. Non-Western sounds also began to be utilized, led once again by the Beatles, whose pioneering work with the sitar showed that there was more to the world of music than just the British invasion. The final ingredient in the mix was drugs, particularly of the hallucinogenic variety. Because while illegal substances had played an important part in previous musical scenes, mods had their uppers, and heroin has long lingered over the jazz scene, for psych, the mind-opening powers of first cannabis and then LSD opened up not only the doors of perception, but blew away any aesthetic constraints songwriters previously felt. A whole new Technicolor era had arrived, along with a new crop of bands. A few landmark psychedelic records of the late 60s were Forever Changes by Love, Odyssey and Oracle by The Zombies, Disraeli Gears by Cream, Axis Bold as Love by The Jimi Hendrix Experience, Incense and Peppermints by The Strawberry Alarm Clock, The Psychedelic Sounds of by The 13th Floor Elevator, and Pink Floyd's debut, Piper at the Gates of Dawn. Pink Floyd would later form the bridge between psych and prog, which I'll talk about in a minute. Pollard got hooked on mainstream psychedelic bands like Moby Grape and 10 Years After when his dad signed him up to the Columbia Records Club. Started in 1955 by music labels CBS and Columbia as a way to sell albums through the mail, the club was an instant success, selling millions of records in its first couple of years. The way the club worked was you got a bunch of records for free, up front, as long as you promised to buy a record a month after. The brand later turned into Columbia House and lasted well into the CD age, finally going out of business in 2010. Pollard, looking through the Columbia Records catalog, picked his initial choices based on either the names of the groups or their covers. This is what initially led him into the world of psych. The bands had the best names and the most outlandish sleeves. Pollard became an instant fan and stayed one. To this day of the four P's, I think psych is where he draws the most inspiration. In fact, the cover of the upcoming GBV album, Mirrored Aztec, is a freaky multicolored painting that would have fit right in 1968. Bob's such a fan of the genre, he's even created a number of playlists for friends, collecting his favorite psych songs. Called, in typical Pollard fashion, Iodine Book Report, there are 4-hour-plus mixes on YouTube. Each one features tunes by a variety of lesser-known lights from the psych scene. Just looking at the names of the bands or the songs, you can see why Bob liked the genre so much. There's Strange Walking Man by Mandrake Paddle Steamer, Poverty Train by The Ark, Glasshouse Green Splinter Red by The Kinsmen, and Stengen by Linda Van Dyke with Boo and the Boo-Boos. Those and pretty much any of the tunes that make up the Iodine Book Report would fit perfectly alongside the fake bands on any of GBV's Suitcase series. However, the thing that struck me when I listened to Pollard's psych mixes was just how much of that stuff sounded like what I'd consider to be garage rock. It sounded like it came from a Nuggets compilation rather than from somewhere in Middle Earth. So the bit of psych that Pollard was drawn to was the more stripped down and raw variety. Think of something like Psychotic Reaction by Count Five, rather than the more flower power sounds of the late hippie era. This makes sense since Bob's basement, cluttered with instruments and beer cans, is basically the same thing as a garage. What he and the guys were pounding out down there for years was a variation on psychedelic-infused garage rock. I mentioned in the last episode a few prime examples. Think of something like Matter Eater Lad. Putting Pollard's love of the genre into historical perspective, psych, unlike prog, which we'll talk about in a second, was an influence that a lot of 90s bands wore on their sleeves. At the beginning of the decade, a bunch of Manchester groups such as Inspiral Carpets and the Charlatans paid their debt to the psych scene of the 60s by prominently featuring Hammond and Farfisa organs in their music. You can hear great examples of the combination of these two eras in a couple of drum machine heavy cover songs from the period. First, there was Candy Flip's version of the Beatles classic Strawberry Fields Forever and went all the way to number 3 on the British charts. Shortly after, World of Twist covered the Rolling Stones' psychedelic single She's a Rainbow. When GBV was making its name in the middle part of the decade, a number of American groups, operating under the umbrella of the Elephant Six Collective and based primarily out of Athens, Georgia, created a sort of neo-psychedelic scene. Some of the groups involved were The Apples in Stereo, Neutral Milk Hotel, Beulah, and Elf Power. One of the best-known bands, Olivia Tremor Control, released their debut album, Music from the Unrealized Film Script, Dusk at Cubist Castle, in 1996. Though it wouldn't have sounded out of place in 1967. And by the end of the decade, Pollard's later TVT label mates, Brian Jonestown Massacre, who were signed by the same A&R man, Adam Shore, were heading a West Coast-based psych music revival, bringing the sitar back to rock for the first time in decades. So Bob and the band, by displaying their psych influence during the indie rock years, were right in step with a lot of other groups. The difference is that Pollard had come to these influences firsthand, hearing some of the big groups of the era when they were brand new. This meant he wasn't treating the genre with any of the distance or irony that so often came in the 90s. Anton Newcomb sometimes imitated or even aped the sounds of the psych scene, whereas Pollard was just a fan, and his love of the sound and of those bands organically seeped into the music. What's interesting is that psych, at its height, was a full-blown phenomenon in the same way punk would be a decade later. It spawned its own fashion, language, and art aesthetic. However, Bob's never dabbled in anything other than the music, taking from psych only as a penchant for outlandish song titles and subject matter. And so, while some modern bands copied not only the sound of the 60s, but also its look, think of a group like Red Cross, Pollard's only in it for the music. By the end of the 60s, sonically adventurous bands weren't content to just don a caftan and incorporate a strange instrument or two. They wanted to go even farther, experimenting with time signatures and taking rock to the absolute outer limits in terms of subject matter, length, and sound. A band who helped lead the way was one who had been a darling of the psych scene, Pink Floyd. As Will Romano writes in his book, Close to the Edge, How Yes's Masterpiece Defined Prog Rock, Floyd created the bridge between psychedelia and progressive with echoes from 1971's Metal. That track, composed by all four group members and clocking in at over 23 minutes, includes sound effects, musical improvisation, and lengthy instrumental passages, touchstones which would all, for better or worse, be associated with prog during its brief spasm of popularity and chart dominance. Pink Floyd, along with the other first-wave progressive rock groups, outfits such as King Crimson, Yes, ELP, and Jethro Tull, transformed what popular music could be, eschewing the pop single format and delivering on the promise of Sgt. Pepper's by elevating the artistic form of the album. It was, as Mike Barnes writes in A New Day Yesterday, UK Progressive Rock in the 1970s, a heady time of artistic freedom and accelerated creativity unique in rock music. However, not everyone was a fan. Even in its heyday, many were skeptical of what was seen as prog's inherent pretentiousness. Barnes going on to write that, self-indulgence was a term that was prevalent in the music press, although it was almost always used pejoratively by the Back to Basics Brigade. But if one looks at it from a different angle, it can just as easily be synonymous with risk-taking, experimentation, boundary-pushing, and unfettered self-expression, doing exactly what one wants. You can see how that would appeal to Pollard, a strong-willed guy who hated being told what to do. The prog influence has cropped up a lot on the last couple of GBV albums. Tracks like Year of the Heavy Hitter and Cul-de-Sac Kids from Surrender Your Poppyfield, with their rapid-fire tempo changes in different segments, are deeply indebted to the genre. In fact, in the podcast episode about that record, I talk a lot about prog and its connection to the band. However, one important aspect of prog that's never really rubbed off on Pollard is the ambition that the era embodied. Because say what you want about those sidelong epics, concept records, or 30-minute organ solos, but all of that stuff was ambitious. You may not like it or want to hear it, but you can't deny the aspirational scale and scope of progressive rock bands. Whether it was in lyrical content, technical prowess, or state-of-the-art recording techniques, the prog scene of the 70s was a masterclass in pushing boundaries and trying to reach new heights. But Bob's never really been bitten by that bug. From time to time, he's flirted with the idea, if not the execution, of a concept record. There was the aborted Power of Suck and the supposed narrative of Mag Earwig, but he's so far lacked the discipline, or just the general interest really, to commit himself to any sort of overarching album-length theme. In his head, Pollard may have felt that each side of something like Alien Lanes added up to a masterwork like Genesis's Supper's Ready, but without the benefit of connective musical tissue, those snippets end up remaining, well, snippets. Pollard's never been short of ideas, in the same way that Yes or Genesis packed dozens of musical motifs and themes into a single tune, but Bob prefers to keep those ideas unassembled and singular. Prog produces epics, Pollard prefers just making it an EP. One figure in particular from the era who had a big influence on GBV was King Crimson lyricist Pete Sinfield. To see how he inspired Pollard, compare these lyrics to Ladies of the Road from the 1971 King Crimson LP Islands to the GBV classic Hot Freaks. Here's the first couple of lines from Ladies. A flower lady's daughter, as sweet as holy water, said, I'm the school reporter, please teach me. Well, I taught her. And here's Hot Freaks. I met a non-dairy creamer, explicitly laid out like a fruitcake, with a wet spot bigger than a great lake. Took me to the new church and baptized me with no salt. She told me, liquor, I am a new man. Sinfield also wrote lyrics for another prog powerhouse, Emerson, Lake & Palmer, for their album Brain Salad Surgery. Phrases from that record like supersonic fighting cocks and a stripper in a till sound like they could have come from the pen of Pollard. Will Romano writes in Close to the Edge, although his phrasing can get pretty erotic, weird, and or sci-fi, Sinfield's words are not nearly so abstract as to be completely meaningless. The same can be said of Pollard. The majority of his lyrics read as surreal, if not just plain nonsensical, but there's actually quite a lot of meaning in what Bob writes. In a different book, this time Mountains Come Out of the Sky, The Illustrated History of Prog Rock, Romano says of Sinfield, his lyrics present the duality and dilemma of the Western world, the divide between the elites and the common people. That duality, or divide, is something that runs through not only Bob's work, but his life. Think of the very first duality that existed, the school jock who was also a rock and roller. You can see this dynamic play out in the band's video for I Am a Scientist. When the clip starts, Bob's looking smart in a blazer. He's an intellectual on the journey described in the song. He's a thinker, a seeker. In the scenes of the band shell, Pollard's on stage while the rest of the band are seated. He's the performer. They're the audience. There's a divide. But a few scenes later, the blazer's gone, as is the guitar, and he's back to being just another one of the guys, tossing around the ball and shooting the shit. King Crimson leader Robert Fripp once said of Sinfeld, he did not know what he could not do. That could also be applied to Pollard. As a working class guy growing up and then choosing to remain in Dayton, the world of rock and roll must have seemed very distant and remote. Blue-collar guys like Bob weren't supposed to set the world on fire, and he never concerned himself with what he couldn't or shouldn't be able to do. Instead, he plowed his own way, making records in garages and releasing them himself, assaulting the world with the crazy creations he'd been directed to make by the voices in his head. And those records, once people began to hear them, were compared to Bob's heroes. Around the time Alien Lanes was released, writer Craig Marks described GBV as King Crimson with a short attention span and a six-pack. The comparison makes a lot of sense. Both bands revolve around a mastermind responsible for the group's sound and direction. In GBV's case, that's Robert Pollard. In terms of Crimson, it's Robert Fripp. Neither band has ever had a stable lineup. Both groups would never record more than an LP or two with the same members. 2 decades later, Pitchfork's Stephen Hayden wrote that, while the King Crimson comparison would have flattered Pollard, it wasn't meant as a compliment in the alt era. Saying you liked Yes, Genesis, or King Crimson in the 90s was the kiss of death. You didn't make friends or garner column inches in magazines by going around back then, or even now really, saying you liked prog. Radiohead, after the release of their epic OK Computer, were asked by reporters whether prog was an influence, to which they quickly replied, no, we all hate progressive rock music. And yet the 6.5-minute lead single, Paranoid Android, with its various segments and shifts in mood, tempo, and instrumentation, follows the prog format to a T. The band's being disingenuous, if not just plain dishonest, to deny it as an influence. In fact, the more I delve into prog, the more I see its fingerprints all throughout 90s indie rock. For example, the title track off the 1974 album Red by King Crimson sounds exactly like Shellac. Or rather, whole swaths of shellac sound just like King Crimson. I would actually go so far as to say the whole post-rock scene, everything from Slint to Sigur Rós, could be described as neo-prog. Musicians and bands then and now refused to be tagged with the prog label merely because of the knee-jerk stigma attached to it, denying the fact that a whole lot of really good music was created by prog bands. And while I won't go so far as to endorse modern prog groups such as Spock's Beard, Porcupine Tree, or Chimpan A, any serious fan of music would do well to give classic prog a chance. There's a whole world of fantastically sublime and beautiful music waiting to be heard. And to not seek it out or reject it outright just because of the genre's bad reputation is nothing less than bowing to peer pressure. Let's now begin to segue from prog to punk. So the popular notion is that prog in the mid-70s had become pompous, self-indulgent, and bloated. Bands like ELP were lumbering dinosaurs that needed, indeed, were begging to be put out of their misery. They were the disease and punk was the cure. Johnny Rotten famously went around wearing a t-shirt that read, I hate Pink Floyd. And the meteoric rise of Rotten's band, the Sex Pistols, since they were popular and got a lot of press, surely killed off Roger Waters' no longer hip band, right? Or at the very least, the Sex Pistols must have let some air out of Pink Floyd's inflatable pig. And yet, that's not at all what happened. By the end of the decade, the Sex Pistols would no longer exist. By contrast, Pink Floyd would be more popular than ever, going so far as to have a worldwide hit single with the disco-influenced Another Brick in the Wall, Part 2. Most of the prog bands not only remained, but flourished. In 1977, year zero for punk, Yes's latest LP, Going for the One, topped the UK album chart, something no punk album managed to achieve. They even scored big in the 80s with Owner of a Lonely Heart. And Genesis, one of the first prog bands and one of Pollard's favorites, not only dominated the charts in the 80s, but was all over MTV. Phil Collins, a short, balding balladeer, became an inescapable presence. Meanwhile, Peter Gabriel reinvented himself as a champion of world music while also having number one hits. Whereas Johnny Rotten's new band, Public Image Limited, had an appeal which was, shall we say, limited. And all of that's okay, since sales and fame weren't really what punk was all about. In fact, another way to look at the whole punk versus prog scenario was that it was much more about class than music. Genesis were the target of abuse, not just because their music was overblown and pretentious. It's that the band members were upper class and rich, even before they were in a band. and Rick Wakeman from Yes studied at the Royal College of Music. When he was there, he had tea with the Queen while at the house of the country's foremost manufacturer of harpsichords. Contrast this with Sex Pistols bassist Sid Vicious, who dropped out of school and later busked on the streets of London, where people paid him to stop playing. English teenagers were tired of seeing rich kids on stage. They wanted to see someone who looked like they did. As Peter Hook put it in his book, Unknown Pleasures, when talking about the appeal of a band like the Sex Pistols, I was intrigued by the idea of a group who seemed, I don't know, human, compared to bands like Led Zeppelin and Deep Purple, who seemed, to a working class tosser from Salford, so out of my league they might as well lived on another planet. Hooky loved those bands, but thought the people who played in them were gods. Prog musicians like Keith Emerson and Steve Howe were virtuosos who took as much, as if not more, from the European classical tradition than they did from American rhythm and blues. And frankly, why wouldn't you try to be a god? No one joins a band or strives to have a number one record because they're modest or want to fit in with general society. Instead, prog wizards wore sequined capes and played walls of synthesizers the size of a Tesco. They'd join bands to be extraordinary. Being ordinary was never part of the plan. Another reaction that punk had to prog was in lyrical content. Mid-70s England was not a fun place to be for a lot of people. An oil crisis led to the firing of workers. This in turn led to strikes and then inflation. At one point, London's garbage collectors went on strike, resulting in massive piles of trash appearing throughout the city. Later, nurses, gravediggers, and coal miners also went on strike. To save fuel, a three-day work week was implemented. Things were dire, and they weren't getting better. And whereas prog provided long tracks that were influenced by fantasy novels or sci-fi, or else contained leftovers from the mystic hippie days of the 60s, punk lyrics confronted the brutal reality of modern life. Prog was escapism, punk was realism. Musically speaking, punk was all about getting back to basics. It was built on three chords and the truth. Songs were short, fast, and full of attitude. Anyone could play them, and just about anyone did. In a few short months, a whole scene was created, because it wasn't just bands. Punk spun up venues, labels, and zines, as well as creating new language and fashion. It was, in short, a whole new world. However, for Pollard, the timing was a bit odd. In 1975, the year the Sex Pistols formed, Bob was a freshman at Wright State University, which he went to on a baseball scholarship. As a jock who was into heavy metal, he'd seen Jethro Tull a bunch of times at the Hera Arena. In fact, as he told Spin in 2004, when punk came in, I was kind of turned off by it. As his college years progressed, Bob became less and less committed to the career in sports his father had been grooming him for all his life. The rebellion, which had previously only seeped out around the edges of Pollard's ordered existence, pushing back against teammates, siblings, and parents, flourished as he began to decide what he was going to do for the rest of his life. One thing was certain. He didn't want to take shit from coaches for the next 20 years. Bob began to see an alternate path, and music was part of it. This is when he began to play guitar and write songs. He also gave punk another chance. This time, it stuck, Bob saying that it just blew my mind how good it was. Punk even began to make its way to Middle America. In 1979, Bob and Mitch Mitchell saw the Ramones at a club called The She in Forest Park Plaza on North Main Street. The club was tiny and grimy, located next to a JCPenney outlet. This was a long way from the huge shows they'd seen previously at the glamorous Hera Arena. There's even a photo of the Ramones show where you can see Mitch and Bob in the audience. Mitch, always the master of outlaw cool, is right up front, sweaty and wearing a leather jacket. He was more into punk than Bob was. He loved the Sex Pistols. Bob's standing a few layers back behind Mitch. You can tell it's a pivotal, if not just a transitional, period for Pollard. Bob, still in college at the time, and with one foot in the world of sports, is wearing what looks like a baseball jersey. He hasn't quite committed to the world of rock and roll. And considering that he'd soon get married, buy a house, and become a fourth grade teacher, it would in fact be decades before Bob fully signed on to the life of a musician. But witnessing bands like the Ramones in the flesh, and being exposed to the punk and post-punk singles he and Mitch were picking up during their weekend trips to record stores in Columbus and Cincinnati, must have, as it did for all the young people who came in contact with the scene, shown Pollard a whole new possibility. Bob suddenly saw that he didn't need to be a virtuoso in the mold of his prog heroes. Instead, just like in sports, punk was all about passion. If you felt it and wanted it bad enough, you could do it. After all, on the playing field, it's not always the strongest or fastest guy who comes in first. Sometimes the one who wins is the one who has the most heart. So what Pollard took from punk was more of an attitude than any sort of sound. He'd already honed his melody chops in the world of pop music and expanded his idea of what a song could be thanks to psych. Prog indulged his love of fantasy, not to mention its multi-part epics played to his sometimes short attention span. Why have one melody or idea on a track when you can have seven? Punk became the final ingredient. As Rolling Stone put it, even if punk rock began as a kind of negation, a call to stark, brutal simplicity, its musical variety and transforming emotional power was immediate and remains staggering. It was that transformational power that Pollard latched onto. It showed that anyone could do it, even guys from Dayton who had only just recently picked up a guitar after throwing off the lifetime expectation set by somebody else to pitch in the majors. Another aspect of punk that spoke to Pollard was its simplicity. The first Ramones LP was recorded for about $6,000, and the idea was to, as Tommy Ramone put it in 1999, eliminate the unnecessary and focus on the substance. That's pretty much the template Bob's followed throughout the rest of his recording career. Musically speaking, other than some abrasive or fast tracks, think of something like Chakra and Gloomtown, I don't hear much of a punk influence in Pollard's work. What seems to have inspired him more, sound-wise, was the period right after that first wave of bands and releases, the genre that became known as post-punk. Because while Mitch Mitchell was digging on the Sex Pistols, Bob gravitated more towards angular bands like Gang of Four and Wire. Pollard's even called Wire's third record, 1979's 154, the greatest album of all time. When Bob finally began making Guided by Voices records in the mid-80s, their debut album, Devil Between My Toes, contained a number of moody and spare instrumentals that called back to his post-punk influences. As Pollard told Matthew Cutter in the authorized biography, The Closer You Are, post-punk is about art. Wire showed that loud rock music could do more than just, well, be loud and rock. That appealed to the Pollard who had made collages since the third grade. Post-punk showed you could be in an art band and a rock band at the same time. Now, that's where Pollard's much-vaunted four Ps ends. We've talked about pop, psych, prog, and punk. And even though it's a clever way to frame his influences, it's not exactly perfect, because it's leaving out some pretty important strands of musical DNA that have repeatedly found their way into and onto GBV's songs and albums. The most important missing ingredient, I would argue, is classic rock. This is identified probably best by The Who, a band which casts a long shadow over Guided by Voices. That group's big rock sound is something Bob's cited in numerous interviews as being something he's been both inspired by and has tried to match in his own musical career. Pollard's gone so far as to say, The Who was totally my model, calling GBV the drunken version of the English band. As a child of the 60s and 70s, the music of The Who hit Pollard at the perfect age, the pre- and post-teen years. Bob even saw the group at the infamous concert in Cincinnati where 11 people were crushed to death. So The Who, along with other acts like Led Zeppelin and the Rolling Stones, staples of what was already deemed classic rock by the 80s when GBV was forming, had a huge influence on the sound and direction of GBV. Because that's really what they were, a neo-classic rock band. As Clint Conley from Mission of Burma once said of his band, "I think we're just a closet prog rock act that happened during punk." Well, I would say that Guided by Voices was a closet classic rock band that happened during indie rock. Because GBV didn't really feel or sound or even look much like Pavement or Sebado, and yet they constantly got lumped in with those bands because of recording techniques, general slappiness, or label proximity. But Guided by Voices really didn't have much in common with these guys. They weren't the same age, and other than a few bands like The Fall, they didn't really share the same influences. GBV has the four Ps, but Pavement has two Ps at best. Sebado has about half a P. Not to mention that a lot of those young guys were in bands in lieu of getting a real job. This was all just to have fun. Pavement's classic track, Cut Your Hair, even lampoons the idea that either someone could or would want to turn a band into a money-making venture, talking with disdain about turning attention and fame into a career. Career in the 90s was a bad word. But Pollard already had one. He had been a teacher for a decade by this point, not to mention he had two kids, a mortgage, and a wife. To put it mildly, GBV just wasn't made for those times. They weren't ironic, they weren't slackers, and if anybody would have played Bob in a movie version of his life at the time, it would have been William Catt, not Ethan Hawke. So why did it happen? Why was GBV lumped in with indie rock instead of being branded neo-classic rock, let alone neo-psych or neo-prog? Well, it's because the band's recordings were too raw for mainstream radio and thus a mainstream audience. So indie rock is where they landed. Because if you think about it, where else could they have gone? Neoclassic rock really wasn't a thing back then. It's barely a thing now. What made GBV not seem like just a classic rock tribute band was that Pollard indeed used all of that material merely as an influence rather than as a template. He was inspired by The Who rather than trying to be just like them, microphone twirls notwithstanding. That's why Jeff Stratton, writing on the website The AV Club, described GBV as latter-day classic rock that still sounds contemporary. Pitchfork, in the same article I mentioned earlier, went a little farther, referring to Alien Lanes as postmodern classic rock and writing that it exemplifies the songwriting and posture of classic rock while also implicitly commenting on rock's cultural decline. That may have been the case in 1995, but in 2020, I don't think that quite holds. When the band tries to sound like The Who now, it's not a meta commentary on the industry, it's just what it appears to be, an homage. And that's okay, since Pollard adds what I call the fifth P to his original quartet, and that's himself. Because everything Bob does is filtered through his own sensibility and outlook, so that what goes in is totally different from what comes out. Yes, the main building blocks of the band may be pop, psych, prog, and punk, but it's that fifth P, Pollard himself, that makes his body of work truly special. It's why the band have mattered and have lasted as long as they have. Bob's the secret sauce in the recipe, the one thing we can't duplicate ourselves at home or in the studio. That's the one ingredient you can't get in a record store or on Discogs. Pollard's brain is like a blender, combining and recombining the four P's, spitting into his boombox mad and wonderful creations like some combination of Dr. Frankenstein and Willy Wonka. And we each get a golden ticket, or a murderous monster, depending on your point of view. Bob's influences are his, and his output is ours. I'd say that's a pretty fair trade. Okay, that's it for the show. Go to everygbblp.com to listen to past episodes of this podcast. Go to rockathonrecords.com to buy Guided by Voices albums on vinyl or CD. And be sure to pick up Zeppelin Over Dayton, Guided by Voices album by album, wherever books are sold. Thanks for listening.